In this video, I'm gonna show you how to build your first NAS. So, what is a NAS? NAS stands for Network Attached Storage, which is basically a server which can host your files or some other services, either locally or over the internet. So, why do you need one? Well, maybe you don't, but hear me out. NAS can be used as a centralized home storage, so all your data can be organized in one place, in one big virtual drive. It's easier to find, easier to backup, and easier to manage. You can connect it to the internet so you can access all your data from anywhere in the world. And finally, a NAS can protect you in a case of disk failure, data corruption, ransomware, accidental file deletion, and many more. Saying all this, I have to warn you that NAS is not a backup. And you always need to have at least one copy of your data. The general rule for backup is 3 copies of data on 2 different media types and 1 offsite location. This ensures that even in the catastrophic event of fire, your data remains safe. But why build a NAS when you can buy a pre-built one off the shelf? Well, there are several reasons for that. Pre-built NAS devices are often tied to the hardware, and when they break, you'll have to buy the same device just to access your data. They have limited space for hard drives, and you can't simply throw in better CPU or more RAM. They are often very good for file storage, but if you want to do any form of virtualization, encoding, or even run some light services, they can easily become overwhelmed. On the positive side, they are much smaller, much easier to set up, and consume slightly less electricity. Speaking of parts, a NAS can be built just like any regular PC. You can even use some older server-grade components if you want, but be aware that rack cases have one big disadvantage, and that is noise. Now let's see the components, starting with a case. Any case will do, but you want to ensure that it has enough space for hard drives, fans, and full ATX motherboard, so it doesn't limit your future expendability. If you're willing to spend a bit more, I personally recommend Fractal Design Meshify 2 or something equivalent. This case is highly modular, spacious, and can host up to 16 hard drives plus 2 SSDs, which is more than enough. The only downside is that you need to buy additional hard disk drive trays. For the motherboard, it really depends on what you want your NAS for. One thing you'll definitely need is at least 6 SATA ports. If you need more, look for a server board or buy PCI to SATA expansion card. Just make sure to buy something proper, like an LSI host bus adapter and not some cheap PCIe controller card. Other considerations include the number of PCI lanes, which depend on the chipset and CPU model, the number of memory slots if you want a huge amount of RAM, the number of PCIe slots for expansion cards if needed, and of course LAN port speed. Be aware that you can always add a dedicated network card if your motherboard only supports a gigabit connection. The NAS I'm building will be used primarily as a centralized storage and backup. So I decided on ASRock B450 board. The main reason is support for ECC RAM, which is very important for a NAS, and I'll explain in a minute. Of all motherboard manufacturers, ASRock and ASUS are the only two that support ECC memory on almost all their boards, even the cheapest ones. However, always double check on the official site to confirm if the specific model supports ECC. For the ECC to work, you also need a processor that supports it. On the consumer-grade side, look for a Ryzen CPU that supports ECC. And on the server-grade side, you can choose whatever you want. But if you're aiming for a budget option, an older Intel Xeon can be a good option. Depending on the purpose of your NAS, you may consider a fast CPU, especially for video encoding. But for a simple storage solution, any CPU with 4 cores will be sufficient. Now, here is one more caveat. Consumer CPUs work only with unbuffered ECC, while server CPUs require registered ECC. Prices may vary, so take that into consideration while deciding which platform to build. For my NAS, I bought Ryzen 3 1200 with 4 cores at 3.1 GHz. I already mentioned memory, but why would you want ECC? ECC is a type of RAM that protects against data errors that can usually occur in RAM. This is very important for a NAS, as it runs 24/7 and hosts all your important data. In a TrueNAS system, ECC memory prevents data corruption that can occur during checksum verification. If the checksum in memory becomes incorrect, it can lead to data corruption on your NAS. So, for my NAS, I found this used DDR4 16GB unbuffered ECC, which I also consider the bare minimum for a system like this. Calculating RAM requirements can be tricky. How large is your NAS? What services do you run? How many users? Do you use virtualization? TrueNAS also uses free RAM as a cache to speed up file operations and will use it all. For the GPU, I will use this old GT710 because I just need something to display a picture. If you plan to do some encoding, then be prepared to spend more money on a proper video card that can do a good job. For the power supply, you can use whatever you like, but you'll probably want something reliable with some sort of power protection. Ideally, aim for the highest 80 plus rating to save on the electricity in the long run. The final and the most important parts of your build are hard drives. For a TrueNAS system, you must install all drives at once, and they must be the same size. For some other systems such as Unraid, you can simply add more drives on the go, and they can be different size. For my TrueNAS, I decided to use RAID Z2 with 4 plus 2 drive configuration. This means I will have 6 drives in an array, and the data will remain intact even if 2 drives fail. There are many ways to do this. The numbers in RAID Z 1, 2 and 3 indicate how many drives in the array can fail. For 8TB and larger drives, it's recommended to use RAID Z2 or RAID Z3. The RAID should consist of 4 to 10 drives, with 8 being ideal. When buying hard drives, look for ones designed specifically for NAS, and always double check that the drive uses CMR and not SMR technology. If, like me, you want to buy used drives, look for ones with the least power on time. So my NAS will have 6 8TB drives, which will give me 32TB of usable space. For a boot device, you can use USB flash drives or SSDs in a mirror RAID configuration. The problem with flash drives is that they tend to wear out quickly, while SSDs can occupy sparse SATA ports or PCI lanes. The solution to this can be a SATA to USB cable, which allows you to connect your SSDs to USB ports. The minimum requirements for a boot drive of TrueNAS is 16GB. I won't specify the price of my NAS, but the lowest cost for a home NAS with space for 6 drives will be around 250 euros, excluding the hard drives. Now, let's build it! The computer has started, everything is working, or at least seems to be working, but now I will have to check if all components are good and is everything working correctly and do some memory testing before we continue building our NAS. To test if the memory is working and if the ECC is enabled, we need to use some software. The best way to check it is with memtest86. Open the memtest86.com and download the software. Choose the free version, open the zip file, extract memtest86 and start image USB. In the image USB, mount the image of MEM test and click write. Accept all warnings and proceed. Just make sure that you don't have any data on your USB drive, because this will erase it all. After making the bootable USB, connect it to your PC and the test will automatically run. If you don't want to wait the test to complete, you can simply stop it and then go into some options and check if your memory is ECC. Now the only thing that is left is to install a TrueNAS operating system. To do this, just search on Google for TrueNAS download and you will see two options. One is TrueNAS Core and one is TrueNAS Scale. Those are two similar versions of the software. You can choose whatever you want, but for this tutorial and for my NAS, I will choose TrueNAS Scale. On the main site, click here, no thank you, I have already signed up. And on the next page, click Downloads table. Now again, we will use the image USB software to make a bootable USB drive. Select the drive and browse for TrueNAS Scale image. Click open and write. This will create the bootable USB drive that we will use to install the TrueNAS operating system. I already mentioned that it's not recommended to use a USB as a bootable device, but I will have to do it because I'm still waiting for my SSDs to arrive. So here is how to do it. Plug in the empty USB flash drive and plug in the bootable USB device that we just created. After the installation starts, select Start TrueNAS Scale Installation. In the next menu, select Install. Here you need to press space and then OK. Do you want to proceed? Yes. And here is the settings for administrative user, TrueNAS admin. Write this somewhere because you will need it later to log in. Here you can select whatever you want, but I recommend configure using web UI because it's easier. Allow FE boot, yes, and now wait for installation to complete. The installation is complete, we will reboot the system, and this means that our job is done. Now we'll continue configuring our NAS from web UI. To access it, you will need to know the IP address of your TrueNAS, and you can find it here in the first row. After you log in for the first time, it's very important that you immediately go and set the password for the admin user. Go to Credentials, Users, TrueNAS Admin, Edit, and here write a new password and just go down and click Save. After that, go to the storage, click on Create Pool and write a name. Just make sure that you use underline instead of space because it can cause some problems in the command line, so it's very safe and recommended to use the underline. Also, be careful with uppercase letters because some operating systems are case sensitive and some are not. So, for example, in Windows, the upper and lower S are treated as the same character, while in Linux or Unix, they may be a different thing. So, keep that in mind. After that, click Next. Select the layout. Here I will select RAID Z2. This is recommended for bigger arrays and larger disks. So make sure that you know why are you choosing and what are you choosing before deciding on what to choose here. Disk size, select here. If your disks are not the same size, you should check this option here and it will treat all disks as the smallest one. So if you have several disks from 8 TB and one disk of 6 TB, the whole array will be created with the disk size of 6 TB. So I don't need that because all my disks are the same size. Width, we are going with 6 and 1 VDEV. Now let's click on manual disk selection to see how does this look. This is our array. Here we can use this to do some things manually, but I don't need to change anything, so I will leave it as it was. Now this is more advanced stuff, we don't need it, so we will click next, 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 pool name Snow White, RAID Z2 6 by 7.28 TB. RAV capacity 29.2 0.11 TB. Create pool, confirm, continue. Now let's create dataset, name, storage. Here select SMB, because SMB is for Windows user, Windows share. Create SMB share, SMB share name will also be storage, and click save. We created our storage and now we need to create a user. Go to credentials, users, add, name, username, password, scroll down and click save. Now go to datasets, select our storage, and here are the permissions. Click on edit. Here you can set who can do and what they can do. Since our user that we just created is part of this built-in users group, he will already have some permissions for our storage dataset. But I want to change that, so I will delete this group of built-in users and I will go here and select user, user name, and here we can select permissions, read, modify, traverse, or full control. I will leave on modify. Here we are, it's added, and I'm gonna click save access control list. As we can see, it showed up here. Now go to shares, check if Windows SMB shares are running and if the storage is enabled. If this is okay, go to system, services, and check it here to start automatically if it isn't. Now let's try to access our share. And here just type the IP address and dataset name. And we can try to create some folders or delete them. Now let's test the speed. This will be much better after I install some 5 or 10 gigabit card. And also don't forget to change your IP to the static one so it doesn't change after your router or NAS reboots. Go to network, click here, uncheck this thing and click add and type in the IP address. It will probably look something like this, or it should be similar to the IP that we are currently using. Just make sure to type some smaller numbers like 10, 15, and here type in 24. Click save, type in the default gateway and click here. To test these settings, click here, test changes, confirm, test. Now you'll have 60 seconds to use the new IP address, login and go to the network settings and save those changes. Now the only thing that is left is to create some periodic snapshot tasks. I will show this in some other video. And then add more users and create more data sets as needed. And that's it. Our NAS is fully functional. If you found this video helpful, leave a like and I'll see you in the next one.